important stuff, like Brandon.
First team of competitors coming out to the floor to tackle event number two. We're going to get that going here for you in just a couple of minutes. Our final event for the fellas. Particulars of this workout here in just a minute. Big shout out and thanks to Reebok out there at their booth. Make sure you go and check them out. They got all kinds of cool gear, regional specific and customizable with your name and number on the back. So go check them out while they last.
30 seconds. Athletes stand by.
right, folks, here we go on the sprint as they make their way out. This was going to be quick, fast, and in a hurry. 6-minute time cap on this event. This event number 2, 21:59, dumbbell snatches at 80, and Rick dips.
And Larry, this one is going to go fast. We got a full heat of athletes. As you can see, they must advance the dumbbell forward. After each set of 7, so 3 sets of 7 here for the 21. Let her make their way back to the beautiful road rig for their ring dips. All right, now Jordy down here in lane number 2. Going touch and go, less than 5 reps remaining for him.
I talked to Jordy between heats and asked him how he felt about this one. He said, this is an all-out grip and rip sprint. And that's exactly what he's doing. Very odd, Peoples heading back to the rig ahead of the pack. But ahead of them, Trujillo, Will Trujillo in lane number 6, already rocking out his rig dips. 1 minute in.
So Grimion and Peoples down here in lanes 1 and 2. Some of our first 2 athletes to make their way back to the rigs. Looks like right now the full field now working on those 21 ring dips.
Cooper Wise, lane number 8, the first to come back out and get that dumbbell movement to the 15 rep area. Now these are going to be broken down 5, 5, and 5. Now Cooper Wise, outstanding performance in event number 1. He's looking to add to that here in event number 2. Will Trujillo out joining him and advancing his dumbbell as well, along with Connor McDonald. Just a moment, catching his breath and going back to work. Hand in the air, though, for Connor, as well as Cooper Wise and Jordy Grimion. And it's going to be Wise the first back to the ring dips. Cooper not wasting any time, going right to work on his ring dips. Will Trujillo, the next to get to the rings, he and Connor McDonald starting about the same time. Jordy Grimion also back at the rings.
Connor McDonald and Grimion down here in lanes 2 and 3 also work on their second set of the dips. But you got the leader right there in front of you, Larry.
Cooper Wise, man, not wasting any time. Cooper moving forward, 3 reps in, 6 to go. Just past the 3-minute mark.
And now Connor McDonald making some moves there on the set of 15 dips as these guys look to finish out the set of 9. Weiss with a slight lead. McDonald not far behind.
Cooper not wasting any time. Cooper with a pretty good clip heading back to those rings, looking to hang on to that lead. 3:38, Cooper with about 8 reps remaining on those ring dips. Cooper Wise out of Norco CrossFit. Finished up with his ring dips, nod for the judge. Don't get in his way, because here he comes. And Wise closes it out right around 3:46.
Connor McDonald heading back to his final set of 9. Jordy right next to him as he sprints back. Trujillo also making his way back. We got 3 competitors looking to finish out that set of 9. But ladies and gentlemen, in lane number 3, Connor McDonald able to get it done out of Norvo CrossFit. Jordy Grimion able to get it done here in lane number 2.
Athletes, we are at 4 minutes and 30 seconds. 4:30 and 6-minute time cap. Less than 90 seconds remaining. And Will Trujillo kicking it into overdrive, and Trujillo will finish up with a time of 4:41. You see on the Jumbotron, got our leaders laid out there. Trujillo 4:41, Grimion 4:25, 4:14 for Connor McDonald, and Wise with a time of 3:47. Reed finishing up at 4:52.
Reed, and now Vargas able to bring it home. Here comes Olsen, able to bring it home. We got about 50 seconds, gentlemen.
Still have two athletes out there. You called it 45 seconds, they can do it. Peebles and Cassidy looking to finish up. Coming up on 30 seconds.
And Derek Peebles out of CrossFit Lubbock. Able to get it done down here in lane number one. That leaves one final athlete.
Lance Cassidy done with that last rep. And Cassidy will take it across the line under that time cap. Lance finished up with a time of 5:41. And I believe that retires the heat. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause for all of our athletes in heat number one. Hats off to Connor Wise, Cooper Wise with a time of 3:46. Unsung Heroes, led by Curtis Harkness, making his way off the floor with a big smile on his face.
Seconds. Ten seconds. Athletes, stand by.
vibrant. Here we go. Heat number two taking the floor again. Don't blink, folks, or you'll miss it. 21.59. Dumbbell snatches and rig dips. 80 pounds. Going up in the air for these fellas. This again, heat number two, lane number one, James Sidwell. Lane two, Grant Belrose. Lane three, Kirk Ritchie. Lane number four, David Barnett. Lane five, Chance Ramos. Lane number six, Pablo Calhoun. Lane number seven, Alan Garcia. Lane number eight, Marika Henderson. And at lane number nine, Quinn Boyer. Hands in the air already. I see Belrose turning and burning back to those rings. Belrose in lane number two, followed by Sidwell and Calhoun.
And you saw with our top competitors here in this heat, a quick touch and go. Those set of seven, 21 reps are in that first portion. Now onto the 21 dips. Belrose looking like he has a slight lead, but down there, Garcia able to get it done. He's going to advance on to the next round, which is 15. Garcia, now Ritchie and Belrose.
Alan Garcia turning that around on the ring dips, man, making short work of that round of 21. And he is five into the snatches.
Once again, they're trying to chase down Weiss, who set down the time to beat at 3:47. And right now, we're approaching that two-minute mark, so we may have a new time to beat, ladies and gentlemen. Garcia, going touch and go. Here comes Henderson.
Man, Garcia sprinting back to the rings. Like I said, he rocked through the 21. I'm sure he's looking to do the same on his round of 15. Definitely getting held to the standard, being told to go a little bit lower. 2:25 on the clock, time to beat 3:46.
Ritchie and Belrose down on my end, moving very quickly, but it's gonna be Alan Garcia. Our first athlete now onto the set of nine. Here comes Ritchie. Garcia and Ritchie going neck and neck here, ladies and gentlemen, at lane number three and lane number seven.
About a one rep lead for Garcia over Ritchie. Oh, they walked up about the same time, maybe about a half rep. It's gonna come down to these last nine dips. 3:15 on the clock.
Ritchie, Garcia, and Belrose all sprinting back to the ring dips.
This could come down to a sprint to the finish, depending on how these ring dips go.
Ritchie and Belrose neck and neck. Belrose has to drop. Ritchie able to go unbroken. And Kirk Ritchie, out of Cityside CrossFit, able to take the top spot. Belrose right behind him. You're one and two. Here comes Garcia.
Garcia crossing the line, 3:56, 3:48 for Belrose. And Ritchie with a time of 3:46.31. Cooper Wise's time was 3:46, but I don't have the hundredth, so we'll have to go to the website to see exactly where he finished, but those guys are neck and neck. One and two overall so far.
Looks like lane number four, Barnett able to get it done. As we approach 90 seconds remaining.
Calhoun and Boyer heading back. Henderson done. Kuika on a sprint. Coming down in lane number eight. And Henderson will close it out. Right around 4 minutes and 40 seconds. Coming up on the 5 minute mark, Boyer down to his last four or five reps.
1 minute remaining, gentlemen. 1 minute. Sidwell and Boyer trying to finish it out.
And here comes Quinn Boyer, lane number 9 out of CrossFit Dixie. And Quinn's going to sprint it to the finish with a time of 5:20. Guys, you have about 30 seconds remaining. Bob Calhoun, lane number 6, looking to finish up as well. Just a few reps to go. And it looks like he and Sidwell are sprinting to the finish. And it looks like Calhoun might take that one. We'll have to go to the scoreboard. Calhoun got it by about 1/100 of a second. 10 seconds, guys. We're going to count it down. 3, 2, 1. And that's time. Lane number 5 making it to the finish just past the horn, finishing up that event.
Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for all the athletes in heat number 2. Great job, fellas. And again, want to check and see where we're getting up with that. People want to go time of 3:46. The fastest time in heat number 2.
Sun is setting in San Antonio, and it's setting on day one of regional competition here inside the Alamo Dome. I'm Jeff Private alongside James Hobart. We've had a very fun day so far with teams getting ready for event number 2 in the men and the women. And James, earlier today, we had kind of the long chipper, but finally, we're going to get to go fast.
Yeah, we're looking for the need for speed here in these final men's heats, and there's a lot to be gained, but not a whole lot of time to do it. We'll see what these athletes can show us right now.
Very fun event number 1. It was a long chipper. We saw some surprises. We saw some favorites do what they were supposed to do. But let's take a look at the overall standings. And Dakota Rager sends a big message to start things off today.
Not the strongest guy on the roster, but moved well, had the right size and arm and leg length to get through that first event. Did not quit. Let's see what he can do here with that heavy dumbbell.
Brandon Luckett also up there in fourth place overall, but a lot of the usual suspects. And Williams up there, and Sean Sweeney. And we've got a couplet, the old 21-15-9.
A couple of guys in this heat right here that I'm looking at. One of them is Jared Enderton in this 21-15-9 dumbbell snatches with the 80-pound dumbbell and then ring dips. I'm looking at a guy like Jared Enderton to move through this quickly. Smaller athlete, but boasts some really huge numbers as far as the clean and jerk and the snatch, so he should be able to move that dumbbell without issue and get through the gymnastics without a problem.
6 minute time cap of the 21-15-9. Here it's heat 3 of event number 2. So two more heats, and we will go back to the old 10 athlete heat, so not so congested. And you mentioned Jared Enderton there in lane number 6. Easy Muhammad did pretty well in the first event today, sitting in lane number 3.
I don't expect the ring dips to be a huge hang-up for a lot of these guys. I want to see them transition fast on that dumbbell.
underway. And again, a 6-minute time cap. Expect this to go pretty fast. The set of 21, they will move the dumbbells up every 7 reps. Right there, lane number 10, that is Joseph Gessner. He was in the games last year. 36, was on CrossFit Lubbock's team back in 2015. That's where he's from. Lubbock, Texas, goes to Double T CrossFit.
Said he's coming into this event with a little bit of a shoulder injury. I'm curious to see how he can hang on those ring dips. He's having no problem at all moving that dumbbell for the first 21 reps.
And again, the veterans to regional competition or even games competition have used the dumbbell. No, to try to carry that dumbbell forward is Kirk Ritchie did it in 3:46.31. That is the time to beat here in Gessner. The first one along with Easy Muhammad. And you notice the red strap their upper back has to touch that. A little familiar, I know, to you, James. Back in 2014, that was part of the 50s on the ring dips when they first introduced that strap.
Sometimes it seems that's like it's a little higher up there than you want it to be. These guys are doing a really nice job. You can see them driving their heels up toward their butts to try and kip those ring dips to move as quickly through them as possible.
Well, no rep that time as Gessner and Muhammad. Gessner at the bottom and the white top. Easy up there in the blue top.
Easy held really fast in that longer bodyway event, which could be said is a weakness for him. But if he can get out a big win here in this heat, maybe the event, it'll really set him up nicely for the rest of the weekend.
Event record is Tim Paulson, 3:05.93. That is the event record set in the East today. Easy Muhammad went to the games in 2015. He's in the blue top, and he's nearly kind of vaulting that up there and catching it on the fly at times. He's actually letting go and catching it on the way down. We've seen the transition of the hand. That's the first time we've kind of let it drop and make the catch.
We can see how much quicker it is than the athlete on the right who's letting the dumbbell rest on the ground. Easy picks up a lot of seconds switching that dumbbell in the air.
That was Andrew and Primo to his right out of Brazil. So here is Easy. And again, he's got that tall, not overly tall length, but a little bit larger range of motion, doing a nice job getting below parallel and touching that strap.
What we need to see here in these next final sets to finish this workout as we move from 15 to 9, athletes have to sprint through that transition. We've talked about it all day. A lot of time is wasted there.
Gessner on a set of 9. He is ahead of Muhammad coming up in the background. So Gessner, a regional veteran, a games veteran, former amateur MMA fighter.
And you'll notice, too, he's muscle snatching that dumbbell. He's not messing around with a power snatch. He is just trying to get that thing off the ground as fast as possible.
Muhammad in his second set of 3 with Gessner. So they are neck and neck. And now Muhammad is last 3. There goes Gessner. He has the lead. A 3-rep lead on Elijah Muhammad.
Gessner's playing this really smart. He's not looking left to right. He's just getting back to those rings as soon as possible. Is he easy trying to be a little bit more aware of what's going on? But he's sprinting back to those rings as well.
Gessner's going to have the time to beat before it's all said and done. 3:47, the time to beat here in the South. He won't have the event record, but he'll make the sprint down the competition floor. He's going to be in well ahead. And right now, he is first overall in event number 2. Around 3:20 unofficially. Here comes Easy Muhammad. He'll like this finish. He's going to get in right about 3:29 unofficially.
These will be solid finishes for both of these guys. Gessner finishing 25th after the first event, first in this heat. Easy finishing, I believe, 11th, 13th after the first event, second in this heat.
Marco Coppola gets in right around 3:41 out of CrossFit Overtake. He was on their team a year ago that finished 31st at the CrossFit Games. And here comes Scott Tetlow. In the blue. Here's Jared Enderton, and up in lane 1, Guillermo Dominguez, but Enderton in again. Solid earlier today, a strength guy, but showing some proficiency, which he needed to, and some of the gymnastics movements, so moved through the dips fairly well.
And a decent finish in this heat. We'll have to see where it stacks up against the other heats. Enderton's 3:59. Once that final heat goes, might not be enough to hang.
Matt Morton having to get down to singles on this set. Again, a 6-minute time cap, so he's only got a little bit over 90 seconds. Again, that is Tetlow in the blue top. And in lane number 7 is going to be Matt Morton. He'll finish up. Under 90 seconds left here in the 6-minute time cap. Back down the floor to Scott Tetlow. And want to correct a mistake I made earlier today. Tetlow had a slide out Louisiana. Accidentally had it as AR on the note card, so apologies there out of Slidell, Louisiana, and out of Arkansas. And Scott Tetlow had to finish strong CrossFit. 24-year-old rookie.
He's having a little bit of trouble kipping those ring dips. It's almost like he starts to press with the arms before the legs start to move up. You want to see the legs drive up first so they can really assist the body as it goes to the top.
Gelson Duarte over there on the left side of your screen out of Centaurus CrossFit in Brasilia, Brazil, 26-year-old rookie, 158-pounder.
And Duarte catching Tetlow there as he sprints toward the finish.
He'll get in under the time cap. Tetlow's got to finish the dips and get down the floor, and he's got 30 seconds to finish up.
Tetlow had a really strong finish in the first event, 9. I'm surprised he's struggling so much on the ring dips here. Looks like he's getting stuck all the way in the bottom.
Gets the kip. He should make it, but he needs to pick up the pace a little bit. 15 seconds. And he's going to make it in under the time cap with about 10 seconds to spare. So everyone in heat number 3 able to get in under the 6-minute time cap. Joseph Gessner, though, the new time to beat, though, set a really nice pace. He and Easy Muhammad going back and forth. But let's take a look at Joseph Gessner.
The biggest thing you're seeing here is how efficient he is on the kip. Keeps to drive those legs up to assist with that lockout. And notice on the dumbbell, muscle snatch every rep. He's clearly strong enough to do that. That's going to be the fastest way to get that work done.
Ian Muhammad going back and forth, but it's the veteran out of Double T CrossFit in Lubbock, Texas. Right now, the time to beat here in the South with 2 heats to go. He was very smooth, very consistent throughout, didn't blow up, so he's standing by now with Nick Zielinski.
A very excited Joseph Gessner, a heat win for you right now, current event lead.
Right.
Did you have any idea this was an event for you to kind of take charge and make a move for the weekend?
Yeah, in practice I did a 5:30, and I didn't even move any of the distance, but after this morning's debacle on the run, kind of put myself in a hole, so I knew I had to make up some time, and I knew I could do it on this one.
So you practiced in a 5:30, you just hit a 3:20. Did you expect to go 2 minutes faster today?
Sorry, excuse me, it was a 3:30. Yeah, so only about 15 seconds faster, but no, when I saw the times out of the East, I knew, you know, it was pretty doable, and this is really, you know, one of 2 heavy workouts, and that's where I got to make up my score, so.
That competition adrenaline kicking in. Games veteran Joseph Gessner, congratulations, see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Joseph Gessner, the heat winner and right now the event leader here in event number 2. And he really did a nice job, as he mentioned, bounced back for that 25th overall finish in event number 1 today. And right now he is your leader in the clubhouse, followed by Easy Muhammad with a 3:30. Coppola and Dominguez, that's the heat, 3 results. But Gessner right now, not only your heat winner, but the overall leader. We'll step aside. Heat 4 is on the way from the Alamo Dome here in San Antonio, Texas. Welcome back into the Alamo Dome. We're getting set for heat number 4 of event number 2. And let's take a look how they're going to line up here in this heat as we're moving up in the heats. Josh Letower in lane number 5. Zachary Moran over in lane number 8. Arturo Machado, who we saw earlier today. And there's Dakota Rager. That's the one to watch here that really sent out the statement today, James.
I don't think Dakota's going to have any issue with the ring dips. I want to see if he can move that dumbbell fast. 80 pounds is heavy. We saw it hold up some of the smaller athletes in the previous heat.
Underway, and again, it's a 21-15-9 dumbbell snatches and ring dips. And the set of 21, they'll move the dumbbell up every 7 reps. Once it gets to the 21 marker, they are complete with that round. And I believe a lot of people, whether it's the ladies or the gentlemen, saw some of the team competition today, and you're seeing a lot more of the transition. You see over lane 1, Andrew Cefali, and Easy Muhammad did that. Not only are they switching hands, they're letting it begin to drop and then controlling it on the way down. As long as you control it down at least waist high, the rep's going to count. If you can't control it above the waist, it's a no rep.
Not a bad bit of hand-eye coordination there, but if you watch these guys, switching on the way down is going to save them almost 1 to 2 seconds per rep. Things are going to move quickly. If you're watching this from home, follow the dumbbell as it progresses up the floor. That's where you will know your athlete is at.
So that is Augustin Garavaglia making his way back in a no rep there. Most of the no reps, I think, James, are going to be on the depth. It's like a squat, like the hip crease getting below the knees. You see Josh there out of Premier CrossFit and Tyler. The elbows have to get below the shoulders. Some people sometimes have the misconception that if the bicep touches, you're deep enough. No, that hip crease on a squat and the shoulder to the elbow have to be below parallel.
Not only do you have to get the shoulder to the elbow, below the elbow, what I also want to see on these athletes hitting the ring dips is keeping those rings in close to the side.
Zachary Moran in front of your screen out of CrossFit Tempe in Tempe, Arizona. He was 7th out of the Southwest. He's been in the regionals, but he's been out east the last 2 years, 22nd and 17th the last 2 seasons, a former D1 wrestler at Sacred Heart.
He's having no problems moving that dumbbell overhead. Nice, strong muscle snatch, quick transition as he brings it down, running back to the rings. This is exactly what we need to see to win this heat.
And the wrestlers usually have no trouble if they're really grinded out, get in the pain cave, it's not going to last too long type of events.
Will that open the door for anybody else here?
Boy, he is kicking through the ring dips. And back to lane 3, Kendall Kersey out of CrossFit D1 in Fort Worth, Texas. Played college football at a couple of different schools as a wide receiver and a quarterback.
Dakota here also hanging tough as he gets back up on the rings. I imagine he'll chip through these pretty quickly.
Walking it forward again, Zachary Moran is crushing it as he is ripping through. Very quick on the transitions as well.
And you'll notice when he walks forward, he keeps it in the same hand. The judges brief that you can walk forward and start your next rep in the same hand. That's also going to save him some time as he heads back to the rings.
May not hit that event record of 305, but he is blistering through this. That's a no rep, so I'll have to get an extra rep, another no rep.
You can see there, he's having a tough time getting the shoulder below the elbow. They're just staying in line. That shoulder has to get and touch that ring.
If he gets off and gets a dead sprint, he's going to have a chance to take the overall lead here in the South, though. Trying to beat Joseph Gessner's 320, and that should do it. In at 316, so he should be your overall leader in event number 2. That's big. Right there at the event lead through 4 heats. So I have one more heat to try to finish ahead of as Kendall Kersey now moves in lane number 3. He's in the blue top, black shorts. Dakota Rager in the blue shorts and the black top. Dakota Rager is going to get, he's going to get second in the heat at 342. And here comes Kersey right behind him at 345.
That's going to be a strong day one finish for Dakota if that score can hold up in the top 10, maybe even the top 15.
Few athletes left to go. They have 2 minutes remaining in the time cap. Augustin Garavaglia out of Latin America, Buenos Aires, Argentina, in at 407. Competed 2 years ago, finished 45th in the South Regional. And Luckett is now in as well, unaffiliated. Lane number 2, it's Arturo Machado out of Brazil, 25-year-old regional veteran out of Furia CrossFit. Just a few athletes in lane number 9, Matt Strand out of Reno, Nevada. CrossFit Regulus was on Timberwolf CrossFit in 2016. Lane number one, Andrew Cefali out of Zero Machine CrossFit in Phoenix, Arizona. He'll beat the cap easily in at 450. So two athletes remaining.
And you wonder if some of these athletes who look so strong to start with maybe just went a little bit too fast. They tripped just over that 95%, went 100%, and then burn out. Now you see them failing, the rings going out to the side, shoulder not getting down to the top of the rings. He's got to try and finish strong here. There's still one more heat to go.
Josh Latour is coming across. He's one of the top athletes here in this heat, but struggled a little bit. In lane number seven, Augustin Richelmey out of Latin American in Buenos Aires. He's one of the big CrossFit members. And again, they've got their team and some individuals here as well. So everyone in under the cap here in heat number four. So let's take a look at how this progressed. And it progressed quickly.
Moran just didn't stop from the beginning. He kept a really solid pace. I think he's one of those guys where he might not have been, went 100%, but just below it and didn't hit that burnout ever. Stuck to his game plan, transitioned in the air with the dumbbell, and was able to move forward without any issue.
So the Division I wrestler from Sacred Heart, now living in Tempe, Arizona. Is your overall leader. And he's standing by on the floor of Nick Zielinski.
Zach, you set the event time to beat so far. What kind of planning goes into an event like this? It looks like an all-out sprint, but what was your strategy here?
Don't slow down and don't break. I mean, it's really not much strategy. It's fast. Just go. No mistakes. Don't drop the dumbbell. I got a no rep at the end. Didn't go as low as I needed to, but I was just rushing.
You just mentioned to me you're worried about your hair coming into this interview.
Yeah.
It looks okay, but how did those handstand push-ups affect that hair coming into this event?
Definitely put a little damper on the hair, but happy to get that one out of the way. Looking forward to tomorrow.
All right, Zach, congratulations. Hair looks great. Good luck tomorrow, man.
Really nice day here for Zachary Moran. Right now he sits as a leader overall. He's 27th in event one, so that will bump him off the leaderboard regardless of what happens in the final heat as he gets in at 3:17:40 and really ran away from the rest of the pack. Was about 26 seconds ahead of the number two finisher in the heat, Dakota Rager. And Dakota's had a nice afternoon here on day one through two events. But those are your heat four results here for event number two, and we have gone fast. We've got one final heat remaining here for the men on day one of individual competition. It comes your way in just a few moments. For all the official information, go to games.crossfit.com. We're back in just a second from the CrossFit South Regional. We are ready for the final heat event on day one from the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. It's heat number five of event number two. I'm Jeff Brywell alongside James Hobart. We've been a little bit long earlier today in the longtime domain. We're going fast here, a 6-minute time cap for event number two. And it's a traditional CrossFit of 21:15 and 9.
What we're looking for from these athletes in this final heat is probably no missed reps. I think all these guys are going to be quick, close to unbroken. Missed reps will cost these top athletes in the final heat.
Let's take a look at how they are going to line up, and we'll take a look at Travis Williams and Marcelo Bruno in 4 and 5. Lanes 4 and 5, Logan Collins looking to make another move here this season. This is a event, I think, James, built for someone like Travis Williams, the short sprint type events. Remember, he did so well on the pull-up wall ball workout a year ago. And if you heard Zach Moran, there's no strategy. You just go and don't break. That fits in his wheelhouse.
And we know Travis likes heavy weights, so I think when he gets those his hand on that dumbbell, he's going to be happy to move it as fast as possible. I think he's a safe bet to see get your fastest time out of this heat.
He and Marcelo Bruno went back and forth earlier today. There is Domingo on the left, shirtless in the gray shorts. On the right, Tommy Venus in the blue top. But there's Travis Williams, white T-shirt. Marcelo Bruno in the tights and the gray T-shirt just off to his, or your right, his left.
We saw Marcelo Bruno put up an amazing time of 10:32 in that 17.1 open workout with burpees and dumbbell power snatches. He should have no problem hammering through this.
Travis Williams, about a 4 or 5 rep lead on Marcelo Bruno right now, about 40 seconds into the event. But Tommy Venus making some noise as well. And so is Tater Domingo up top. And it's going to be Tommy Venus you see in the blue shirt up top, and in lane number 8, Logan Collins, one that you wanted to watch. So again, we have taken a look at those two guys in the middle, but it's Tommy Venus in the blue top out of Zero Machine CrossFit in Phoenix, Arizona.
Tommy Venus also sporting some really serious weightlifting numbers. It looks like he has a 370 clean and jerk, 300-pound snatch. So again, dumbbell not an issue for him as long as he can get those reps to count on the dips.
Last 5, and Travis Williams is back out. So Travis Williams goes back and gets ahead of Tommy Venus on the ring dips as Venus will come out. And again, Logan Collins, quietly at the bottom of your screen in the white shirt.
Sometimes with these quick events, if this is your first time at regionals, it can be hard to know how fast to go. And it's no surprise to see Travis and Logan out front. They've been here before. They understand how hard you got to step on the throttle.
Travis, I don't even know if it was a rep. It's more like a step into the next section. And now Williams into his last 5. Logan Collins right behind him. Collins in lane 8 and Williams in lane number 4. Travis Williams right in front of you, 4th regionals appearance. And again, trying to get back to the games for the 3rd time. He made a big jump up to 19th a year ago. Logan Collins is going to beat him back to the rings, and that is very key.
And you see Logan look over, give his fellow competitor a little smirk, and he's right up on the rings. He's got a nice, efficient dip, quick up to the top. It's not slow in labor, and you see the heels just kipping toward the butt to assist him a little bit.
One of the top 3, Tommy Venus had the early lead before Travis took it away, and so did Logan Collins. So Venus in 3rd. We'll see who comes off the rings, and it's Logan Collins now well ahead of Travis Williams. Collins in the white shirt, black shorts, pulling it forward. A Games veteran, he and Travis Williams. They've known each other for a long time, so they'll compete with each other. And I believe it's about 3 snatches. We're in the rounds of 9, so they move up every 3. So he's got a 3-rep lead over Travis Williams.
Still looks like he's going to have a hard time taking the event world record, but he's well on his way to setting an event record here in the South.
Zachary Moran, a heat to go, 317.40. Collins has to get back. It's going to be tight. I don't know if he's going to overtake Zachary Moran. He's going to get the 9 dips and make the sprint. So he's going to have a good time. I don't think he's going to have the time to beat today, though. Moran, 317.40.
Venus staying aggressive, pulling ahead of Travis Williams, getting back on those rings. For a 200-pound guy, he's moving efficiently on those. Just comes down to whether or not he gets a no-rep, and there he is.
There goes Logan Collins, and Logan Collins is in at 324 unofficially. 324 will put him 3rd overall today as Venus got in. Here is Travis Williams in at 333, and that should hit him about 4th or 5th overall today. Lane number 6 looked like Nicholas Heck getting in. And it was, and there is Marcelo Bruno. Bruno is in 350, and that should be... it's going to be right around top 10, maybe 11, depending on the rest of this heat, as Sean Sweeney trying to round out his dips. Sweeney with a little bit of a frustrated look on his face coming off of those dips. And he is just moving forward to the round of 9. So Sean Sweeney, a little bit of look of frustration. Lane number 3, Maximiliano Aragassi out of Buenos Aires, Argentina, a 24-year-old rookie.
That's got to be tough for the veteran games competitor in Sweeney. I'm not sure if he was hitting no reps on the dips or something was going wrong on the dumbbell. but he looks like he was struggling a little bit as he came off the ring dips.
Lane 10 in the blue top, Gabe Swama at a Zero Machine CrossFit in Phoenix, Arizona. And in lane number one, Tater Domingo. Fourth out of the South Central in Luling, Louisiana, River Parish CrossFit. Again, a six-minute time cap, so a little bit over a minute remaining here. Should be the round. Let's get a long round here if he was just getting into that.
I think one of the things Sweeney's struggling with here is just the fact that he's not really kipping hard with the lower body. The upper body's having to do an excess amount of work. When you're a big, strong guy, you see the judge telling him to get a little lower. He's shaking his head, no, no, no. So there's something he's unhappy about with the judgment call there, but she is the final call.
Well, Adrian Bosman, a couple of years ago on the Fittest on Earth documentary from 2 years ago, I believe, in an Athlete Village talking about judges and people wanting to appeal. Lane number nine, Rodrigo Valenzuela, says the person whose heart rate is not at 180 probably has a little bit better perspective at the rep.
Adrian Bosman, no reps given.
Here's Sweeney. He's going to beat the time cap. And we'll see where this places him after day one. So everyone is in under the cap of 6 minutes, but Logan Collins didn't get the time to beat, but he's up there second overall, I believe. Second or third overall today. And let's take a look at Logan Collins. Nice transition on the dumbbell.
He was so fast on the ring dips. I think that's what helped him kind of chip away and pull ahead of Travis Williams, because a lot of other guys were quicker than him on the dumbbell. He stayed steady there and opted to go a lot faster on those ring dips.
Collins getting in. Again, one of the best times today. Just missed Zachary Morin's overall time. And he's standing by with Nick Zielinski.
Logan, two very good finishes for you in day one. How would you classify day one? How did it stack up to your expectations?
Had a couple slip-ups on event one. I think I held top three on that, so I was hoping for a first place finish for sure on that one, as well as this one, but those boys were going pretty quick on that, the heats before us, so just says that can't really rely on, you know, your heat and how fast that's going to be. So tomorrow, just come out, focus on what I can do, and stay within myself, but try to sneak out some more good placements, so yeah.
He just said tomorrow's a lot of pain. I think we can tell Logan Collins likes pain. He'll be great tomorrow. Logan, thank you very much. Congrats.
Thanks, sir.
Logan Collins, outstanding performance here to wrap up competition day one for the men, as Collins will have the third best time today at 325.97. Zachary Morin still the overall winner of event number two at 317.40. Outstanding day of competition on day one. We have four events left over the next 2 days here from the Alamo Dome. But now we will send it back out to the HQ studios, and we will get an update. Women's competition still to come, so stay tuned right here. But for right now, for James Hobart, I'm Jeff Brightwell. Let's go back out to CrossFit HQ.
Zach Morin picking up an event win in the South as the men close out day one of competition. Welcome inside the CrossFit Update studios, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland with Annie Sakamoto and Pat Sherwood. Once again, it's only day one, but it's looking like, as far as the men are concerned in the South Regional, this thing is going to be wide open.
Definitely. There's a couple of names that we were looking for. Logan Collins, Travis Williams, Sean Sweeney, names that we've seen go to the games before. But then there's a few names that we weren't necessarily looking for or haven't seen.
And that's what makes the South so wonderful. And I'll kind of bring the audience into a private joke that we share here, you know, at the desk, which is the South. It is the Wild West. I mean, it keeps us on our toes. The leaderboard, it seems like it shifts every year up until the final event. And we're having a fantastic year. Dakota Rager, Logan Collins, two people that we weren't chatting that much about heading into this, but looking great at the end of day one. But I still think consistency overall, keep your eye on Travis Williams.
Yeah, Travis Williams came into that event in second place. We don't have updated standings yet, but it's possible we might have a tie on the top spot of the leaderboard, but we're going to wait until the official results shake out, get you updated on that. Let's go over to the women's side of things. They will be next to take on event number two, and that will close out day one of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals. Camila Bloch-Bazinet, her 24th career regionals event win in event one. Tennille Reed right behind her. Now, one name that we don't see on this list is Margot Alvarez. She finished 16th in event one. Still five events remaining, but is there any concern here for her?
It's a bit surprising, I think, to see Margot in the 16th spot right now. Like you said, there's a whole weekend to go. There's two more days. There's four more events. So a lot can change. It is the Wild West.
Right.
So we know that things can shift, but I wouldn't have put her at 16th right now.
To answer your question, is there concern? Yes, there is concern. There's not imminent danger, okay? But like we said, there's six events. There's not seven. I mean, every time there's a reduction in the number of events, your ability to kind of punt one into the stands and recover over the long run goes away. And so this, Margot's not doing herself any favors on day one.
Event number two up next, just saw it with the men. Just as a reminder, it's 21, 15, and 9 of ring dips and dumbbell snatches. Who do you like in event two?
I'm going to go with my gut on this one.
Okay.
I like Candace Wagner. I mean, I see this as grunt work, and I think that is just her forte. She's a three times games veteran. She's a United States Marine Corps veteran, owner of CrossFit Iron Horse, one of the older athletes out there, 32 years old, but she's got the experience. She can grind it out, and she needs this. She's in fifth place after event one, and if she wants to close out day one in that top five, the pedal to the metal.
And I'm going to go with Bethany Brown. Mm-hmm. So she is a 23-year-old regional rookie. She actually not only won the South Central region, but she finished 20th worldwide in the Open. She has 8 years of gymnastics in her background. She's done some half marathons and some triathlons, which obviously lent themselves to that third-place finish that she got on the first event. The gymnastics background, I think, will definitely help her as well on the ring dip. So my eyes are on her.
Women up next. Want to get you updated now on the official men's standings after two events. And Logan Collins is now on top of the overall leaderboard by 10 points over Travis Williams. Dakota Rager, who came in with the lead, is 11 points back at the top spot. Tommy Venus moving into the top five. And Cooper Wise, some familiar names there like Elijah Muhammad. Joseph Gessner was 25th coming into this event. He is now in eighth place overall. So here we go again with the South Regional. It's going to be a lot of fun as we try to get this thing sorted out. Probably going to take all six events before we know the five men who are going to the CrossFit Games. We're going to get you back out to action here in just 1 second as the women are up next for event number two. But stick around after that. We will have a full recap of everything that happened in the East as well as in the South. We'll recap the men, women, and the teams. But now back out to San Antonio, Texas.
Thank you, Erasmus, for getting me the games, but thank you, Erasmus, for helping my body. not going to want to miss this. 6 minute time cap, short and spicy. Heat one coming up in just a minute. Thirty seconds. Stand by. And they're off, ladies and gentlemen. Heat number one, event number two, the last event of the day. This is day one, in case you weren't aware. Any regional season started off right here with the South Regional. Ladies are going to get it done. They have to get it done under 6 minute time cap. That is a 55-pound dumbbell that they're working with right there. It is 21.59. Dumbbell snatches and break dips.
And Meredith Smith coming out hot here on the set of 21, going touch and go. Whitney Hughes not far behind. Jamie West as well. Bergen, West, Freeman, and now Hughes. Hammer as well. So we are closing 3.5 minutes.
Ramsey taking back into the road ring. We saw her take the lead. Once they hit those lifts, she was able to walk away first. That's set of 21. Let's see if she can do it again with a set of 15.
Now going into that final set of dumbbell snatches, Bergen with a slight lead over Hammer. And here comes Freeman. So you're 1, 2, and 3. Already on that final set of dumbbell snatches. Alex with a slight lead.
You saw dumbbell snatches in the open. The ladies, though, working with the men's open weight. Fellas, it's 55 pounds for the ladies when you get to regionals. The guys, they bump it up to 80 pounds. But here we go, Freeman working on her last set of three. Meanwhile, Alex Virgin in lane number 7 back in for more dips. Athletes, you've got 1 minute, 1 minute. 10 seconds. Stand by. Heat number two is off and running to that dumbbell. 55 pounds. They're going to be throwing it around back and forth, alternating between reps. Check out Bolin. Switching up at the top. I don't know. Todd's coming to get the skinny on that. At any rate, it is 21 dumbbell snatches, 21 ring dips, then sets of 15 and 9.
Looks like a handful of competitors going with that switch at the top method. Alyssa Christian and Kelsey Keel also making moves that way. Vanilla as well.
Tell you what, Morgan Bolin though, making it look effortless right there. We know she is working hard. Don't be fooled. There goes Steen, Kelsey, and Morgan. Beth also over in lane number one, about ready to hit those 21 dips.
So right now these ladies work on the 21 ring dips. They're gonna make their way back to the dumbbell here in just a moment for 15 more snatches. We approach 90 seconds in.
Kelsey Keel, Steve Pinay over at lane number seven. They were first in the rings. Will they be the first to emerge? Beth Spearman in lane number one is trailed closely by Steve Pinay. It is going to be Beth Spearman with a one rep lead over the other two ladies as we hit 2 minutes in. 4 minutes remaining.
And going rep for rep down here. Keel and Vanilla back and forth. Looks like Keel now with a slight lead. Just a little bit more speed here on the dumbbell. Steen not far behind.
Those two athletes literally separated by one rep, but I tell you what, Kelsey Keel seems to have the quicker pace over there. 2.5 minutes in, yes she does, flipping it around, but here comes Steve Pinea. Trailed slightly by Beth Spearman in lane number one. So Steve gets to work on those dips first. It is one, Steve, two is Kelsey Keel, and then three is Beth Spearman over in lane number one. Up for Steve Pinea. A hand up for Kelsey Keel. Let's just know they've got a handful of reps to go. Lane number seven. That is Miss Steen who's able to emerge first. She is followed very closely though by Kelsey Keel and Beth Spearman. We've been saying their name all heat long. That's because the one, two, and three has shuffled back and forth between those three athletes.
And Kiki is probably gonna come down to the final nine ring dips as these ladies are blasted through these dumbbell snatches, no problem. Vanilla with a slight lead here. Keel not far behind though.
2 minutes to go, 2 minutes to go. Steve with one rep, two reps. She's going for singles, but she's consistent at them. There's three reps for Steve. Can Keel pass her? Maybe it'll be Beth Spearman. Let's see who gets to that race first.
Kelsey Keel going with some bigger sets. Seeing if she can make up some ground, as she will down here in lane number nine. And it's gonna be Kelsey Keel, followed by Spearman.
Kelsey Keel coming out as an individual this year. You saw her compete at the games previously. On a team, 1 minute to go, athletes, 1 minute. And Steve Panea, also under that finishing mat. 45 seconds to go. Raven Barrett, 30 seconds to go. Raven Barrett in lane number 3 in the maroon shirt, looking to finish this sucker up. Here she comes. Put your hands together for Raven Barrett.
15 seconds, athletes.
10 seconds. Kelsey Keel, excuse me, taking that heat.
What was the time breaking up there? 4:44? Sounds good. We'll go to her scorecard. 8:3 on next.
Sun setting here in downtown San Antonio, Texas. Three heats remain on day one of competition inside the Alamo Dome. I'm Jeff Brywood alongside Cherie Chan. So three heats remaining in individual women in event number 2. Cherie, earlier today we had the longer time domain. Now we get to go fast.
It's getting pretty exciting. We have one event down out of 6, so this is going to be event 2. And we bring on the dumbbell, which is a little bit of the theme for the regionals this weekend. It's going to be fun to see this sprint. It should be fast. I'm looking to see if we'll have some women go sub-4. That'd be pretty exciting.
Let's take a look at the standings so far through event number 1 earlier today as we get set for event number 2. Camille LeBlanc-Mazinet, a dominating performance earlier today, has 100 points in the bank.
And you can see on the point score, you lose 5 every time you lose a place until you get down into that 7th place, and then you start losing a 2-point separator there.
And that's how they stack up through event 1 earlier today. And in event number 2, Cherie, the classic 21-15-9.
So fun. 21-15-9 of dumbbell snatches. That's going to be 55 pounds and ring dips. I don't foresee this dumbbell being a problem at all for these ladies, so it's really going to be more about the ring dips and the proficiency on the ring dips in order to actually get a full rep there. The cap is 6 minutes. We'll see if anybody even butts up to that in this heat.
Take a look at how they are going to line up here for the third heat of the afternoon here in event number 2. And Candace Wagner, really good earlier today in event number 1. She is in lane 7, a 5th place finish in event number 1. So that's where she stands overall. Another solid finish here. She can really move up maybe into the final heat tomorrow as you take a look at the athletes as they get set to start.
That's Caitlin Cassie. She's the other one who did very well this morning, 6th place finish in this morning's event. So looking to her to see if she can stay in that top 10.
So Cassis earlier today is solid, unaffiliated this year, 22-year-old, was on CrossFit Davis team a year ago, and she was individual back in 2015.
Stand by.
Underway in a six-minute time cap. We'll start it off with 21 dumbbell snatches. They will move forward every seven reps.
This is going to be fast, and what you'll see here, a difference from what we saw in the teams, is a lot more of these athletes are doing this transition that you see Candace Wagner doing, almost even a throwing of the bell up in the air and catching it with the other hand on the way down.
Currently in fifth overall, she went to the games a year ago after missing for a few years. She won the South Central Regional back in 2010, also qualified in 2012, where she finished 29th at the games, but trying to get back-to-back games appearances.
This will be fast and furious. We'll see the separator as soon as we get over to those rings.
Again, the athletes, if they did know or they didn't try and practice, they've seen enough heats to know. Carry it overhead to your next section. Just come down with it and control it. Now here we go, Sheree, as you mentioned, the separator. We haven't seen the dips in the ring band behind it where they have to touch since 2014, since we did that long 50s chipper.
Anything that's ever come up before, though, you have to expect it's going to come up again. This is such a not easy but simple movement for gymnastics, so you do expect to see this come out.
Candace Wagner on your right in the black tank top, off to the left, Ariel Armstrong out of CrossFit Abilene, as you take a look across the Rogue Rig here in the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. And again, you've got to break parallel. It's similar to a squat, hip crease below the knee. Shoulder has to be below the elbow. Sometimes a little misconception that if you can just touch the bicep to the ring, that's a rep. But you have to get below parallel.
You do, and this is Candace Wagner right here in the middle. She's got a very interesting circular technique in there that she's using to get herself, get momentum to be able to lock out those shoulders.
So Wagner begins her set of 15, and they will move the dumbbell up every five reps. Ariel Armstrong, you got to have Abilene, Texas.
Ariel Armstrong, she is a contender. She came in 12th in the regional in 2016, and she got 10th earlier this morning in our longer event.
If she can handle the dumbbell with some proficiency, should fit into what she is good at. A gymnastics coach, and right now a full-time grad student at Hardin-Simmons, but a gymnastics background. The ring dip shouldn't, we will see if it does. It shouldn't slow her up too much. Lane number five, Renata Pimentel out of Brazil in the blue tops and the black tights. CrossFit Gurkha down in Brazil. A lot of Brazilians, a lot of Argentinians here in the Latin American regional. They seem to have dominated between teams and individuals as Wagner is back. And there goes Pimentel in lane five in the blue top and the black tights. Almost, you mentioned that as you just saw Candace Wagner. We talk about the kipping dips. You talk about kipping pull-ups. She almost has a butterfly pull-ups, as you mentioned, that circular motion that she does.
She does, and this one is a little bit slower, a little bit labored. I think that if she tightens that up by the time, if she makes it to the games, that is actually a much quicker method to cycle through on those dips. But it looks a little labored with the skill here right now.
Down to our last five reps in the round of 15 and the quick round, the sprint round of nine.
You do have to move your whole torso down and up as opposed to just cantilevering forward over.
Quietly, Renata Pimentel in first place, the event record, and Carol Ann Reason-Tebow, what a day, two event records, 404.79. Pimentel won't get the event record, but she's trying to get the time to beat.
And it was really that proficiency, that quickness that she had on her kipping dips that pushed her ahead here quickly.
Looks like 444.5 is the time to beat here as Wagner in a black tank top right in front of your screen trying to catch Pimentel. But Pimentel on her way back to the rig, but Wagner closing the gap. We'll see what they do on the dips.
They're trying to beat Kelsey Cannell from the second heat with a 4:44 time, and they're getting pretty close to that right now.
We've seen several athletes break the final round into nines, and there's that butterfly kip I'm seeing for the first time on ring dips.
I have definitely seen it before. You can make that a little bit quicker, a little faster. You're probably going to see that again in the next couple of heats as well.
Well, a former competitor in the Southwest, of course, Chris Spieler has that great great video on YouTube of how to do the butterfly pull-ups, and he talks specifically about a reverse bicycle kick. That's what you see in that kip right there. And there goes Candace Wagner. Candace Wagner is going to come in a little over 5 minutes, about 5:08, 5:09 officially, unofficially. So she's going to be right around third or fourth if she got in ahead of Estina Pinella officially. And there is Renata Pimentel who is in. So Wagner's going to be... Few athletes remaining. Lane number 9, Teresa Trojanowski out of CrossFit Central Houston will get in under the cap.
What a fun event, and just a separator of an event with ring depths involved, because you can see there, there's some women left out there on the field. That is not an easy skill to have.
About three of the individuals unable to finish it up and get capped out in Candace Wagner. Quick look there, and boy, she turned it on and had that great kip on the ring dips. 509.66 is your heat winner here in event number 2.
Heat number 3, and Candace Wagner came out with that dumbbell just on fire. What a great transition she had of that dumbbell. A little bit of laboring here on these dips, but she turned on the fire at the end to be able to sprint through and just barely edge out her other competitor there, which was... I'm having trouble with some of the Latin American names, I have to be honest with you. Pimentel.
Right.
Yep.
Renata Pimentel out of Brazil, but it's Candace Wagner who is in, and she'll be, like we said, off the time to beat, but she still should have a top 5 with 2 heats remaining. That's going to do it for heat number 3 of event number 2. Stay tuned. We have heats 4 and 5 on the way in just a matter of a moment. Sri Chan and I'm Jeff Brightwell. We'll be right back here from the Alamo Dome. Just 2 of the competitors right there in Tenor Reed and Brista Mayfield who will try to finish off a day 1 of competition at the South Regional in the Alamo Dome in downtown San Antonio, Texas. I'm Jeff Bright alongside Sheree Chan. Just 2 heats to go, and all these athletes trying to stay up in the 4th and 5th heats after a mass heat earlier today in Event 1. Separated. We went a little bit long today on the chipper, but it is going to be fast and furious here in event number 2.
Fast and furious with dumbbells and ring dips. Talk about a separator with those ring dips. We're going to see if Tanel Reed, which I think she can, she got a second place this morning, if she can clinch a fast time here. Forget about the fact that her other competitors, she's got to beat the heat after her as well to be able to stay up in that second place.
And if you have done CrossFit before, you're very familiar with the numbers 21, 15, and 9.
It's a saucy little combo.
That's what we'll see in the dumbbell snatches and the ring dips. And again, as you mentioned, Sheree, this is really coming down to the rings. As you see in the forefront of your screen, the long look through them. The strategy is you just pick the dumbbell up and keep going, but can you get through these ring dips to see quickly how they line up? You know, Reed in lane number 5, who you had just mentioned.
10 seconds.
in heat four of five heats.
Stand by.
On your way, and they're onto their set of 21 dumbbell snatches. They will move the dumbbells up every seven reps, so those watching online can watch their progress along with us.
Don't expect them to have any trouble with this dumbbell. You'll just have some efficiency differences and some speed differences. Can they transfer that dumbbell in the air as it comes down on the way down, kind of save them a little bit of time, a little bit of work, which is a lot of time over the course of an entire event.
Tanil Reed in the black top off to your left, the early lead. She's unaffiliated this season, was 11th in the games a year ago. In her debut, she is a regional veteran of several years.
Right here in the screen in the blue, that's Ty Lynn Roshan. She's from CrossFit Albuquerque. She actually took 7th this morning, so she's cruising right now through that dumbbell.
Right, Tanil Reed setting a blistering pace on the depths. A lot of focus there for Tanil Reed. Again, 29 years old, a 5'6 athlete. Again, an outstanding rookie season at the games after having some close calls.
Here's what I love about what she's doing. She's not taking her hands off of the rings as she takes a break. She did get a no rep there, which is why she did, but she's just staying right close to them.
Lane number four, Jessica Alabouette out of San Antonio, Texas, a local. So it's going to be Alabouette going against Reed. Alabouette in the turquoise top, Reed in the black top on the right side of your screen.
Alabouette from Lone Star CrossFit.
444.5, the time to beat Kelsey Kill, did it back in heat number two. Anna Swagger made a run at it in heat three, fell a little bit short. So Kelsey Kill still the leader. Now Lennon and Reed, we'll see who the first is back to the ring does.
This is great for Tanel to have an athlete next to her pushing her, because again, right now Tanel's sitting in second overall. She has another heat behind her, so she's competing against more than just these 10 women on the floor.
Tanel Reed, 5-rep lead on the ring depths, and here comes Alouette next to her. Not lead to about 1 rep now. Looks like Reed taking maybe bigger sets, 5 or 6 reps here, breaking it up into sets of 5 potential. Alouette out of Lone Star CrossFit here in San Antonio, Texas. Was on Lone Star's team a season ago, but has been individual twice.
And she took 11th this morning, so strong showing this morning.
So Reed will get to the final set of the dumbbell snatches first. Alouette right behind her.
Oh, I love the transitions. You see how they, you can tell they want it. You can tell that they're ready for the weekend when they're just sort of running to get to that dumbbell.
Couple of reps as we hit the 3-minute mark, which means that Tanil Reed flirting with the event record, Caroline Reese and Tebow, 404.79. That was just her second event record of the day. So if she can get these 9 ring dips and get a sprint to the other side, she's going to have a chance here, a little under a minute to do it.
She has a great opportunity to take first place in this event here today.
Unless she just blows up, which there is no sign of that, she will have the event win here in the South. She got a no rep there.
But again, keeping her hands on these rings as she goes through, key.
404, and there's Alouette. We might have 2 athletes. Jessica Alouette will get the event record. Right behind her, Tanil Reed. Both of them beat Caroline Reason Tebow's time from earlier today in the East. And boy, that was a fun race to watch between those two athletes, just back and forth.
We saw it. We saw sub-4. We saw it. That was pretty amazing. Phenomenal.
The amazing thing is, this is just the first week of 3 weeks of regional competition. They have set the bar high. We'll see where this time is when we get to week 3.
Yes, each week it just gets tougher and faster.
So we'll see who else comes in. Still under the prior time to beat. Kelsey Kill is 444.
And to put that in perspective, a five minute is an amazing time on this, let alone sub-4.
Connor Rashawn in the blue top on the right of your screen. Looks like Chris Schmidt on the left side of your screen in the black top and the blue shorts out of Brazil. And Rashawn out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, and CrossFit Albuquerque. Schmidt right there in the black top out of BSB CrossFit. Is trying to get that locked down. Looks like Brista Mayfield on the white top and the black shorts.
From CrossFit TBR.
TBR located in Anna, Texas. Five-time regional competitor, 11th in the South a year ago. So she was hanging around trying to make that next step. Maybe get to Madison, Wisconsin. She'll be in about 5:19. That is a very solid finish here in this event as Rashawn is going to come in as well. Mayfield is going to have a top 10 overall in event number two, and Rashawn May as well. Lane number one, Marina Ramos-Jorge, two-time regional competitor on a team, two-time as an individual out of Latin America.
There's still about five females out there on the floor, and the struggle has not been that dumbbell.
Chris Schmidt trying to get in under the time cap, and she's going to have it by just a couple of seconds. So what a race we had right there. Jessica Alvillette, the seventh seed out of the South Central here from San Antonio, Texas, 34-year-old, but a regional veteran, was on Lone Star team that finished 17th a year ago, but she's been individual back in 13 and 14. And it was her and Tennille Reed that really pushed each other.
Back and forth, and how fun for them to have each other in this heat. There on the right, you have Tennille Reed, and on the left, you have Alouette, who is already qualified as a Masters. And it wasn't until that last set of ring dips that we saw Jessica Alouette just edge out Tennille Reed right here for that first, and it might be because of those quick, fast singles.
See the sprint all the way down and just edge out Tennille Reed. Let's go down to the competition floor. Here is Nick Zielinski.
Jess, did you have any idea what the event record was going into that event? Because you smoked that event right there.
Did I? I have no clue. I don't even know what it is. I'm not sure what I got.
Well, you beat it by 25 seconds. Did you expect that coming into this event?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I knew it played to my advantage. I really like ring dips, so everything kind of added up for me.
Let's talk about your Masters qualification a little bit. You have already qualified. You are already guaranteed a ticket to Madison, Wisconsin, but you have done excellent so far in day one here at the South Regional. Did you think this was going to come today?
You know, I'm out here to do my absolute best. I know I've got a ticket already going to the games, and I'm completely awed by that. I am completely excited about it, but you know, I'm actually here to do my best, and if I can earn a top five slot and go individual RX, then that's what I'm here to do.
So safe to say your mindset, has it changed at all going into Saturday, Sunday?
Just
in general, you're sitting very highly right now. You said you take the individual RX if you can get it. Does that change your game plan at all?
No. I come out here, every workout is different, and it's on. I come out here, I get my 100%, and move on to the next one.
Awesome. I hope I can get to talk to you later in the week, and this is a great story to watch. Jess, congratulations.
Likewise. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Jessica Alouette, San Antonio's own, with the event record and crush it. We're going to stay right here as the athletes are already taking the floor.
That ring. We have 21:15.9 dumbbell snatches at 155 and ring dips. It's going to be fast. It's going to be furious. We've already seen two females here today break that 4-minute mark. We'll see if we can see any more.
Well, we're into the final heat of this statistically by seed is your top 10 female athletes and Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet in lane number four. Boy, sent out a statement earlier today in event number one.
Camille is not going to have any trouble with ring dips, so she could very well just take a 1-1 right here. We're about to find out, but she is definitely a favorite for this event.
A lot of veterans in there as well. Margot Alvarez in lane three, looking maybe for a little bit of a bounce back event today to set her up for day number two. With a long time veteran, the 2014 Games champion, again, just graduated, and we saw that a lot with Julie Fouché when she was working through medical school and other athletes trying to get through school. I don't think a lot of people factor in the stressors that provide while you're training. And now just the mind free with the graduation, Pastor. Underway, we are looking for a blistering pace. 21 dumbbell snatches. They will advance every 7 reps, so you can keep up watching at home along with us where they advance down the mat.
You cannot think at this point. You need to just go, and you need to be ready for it to hurt. Right there, you've got Bethany Branham. She is somebody to watch at this regional. So exciting. It is her first regional appearance, as you can see there, but she came in out of 20th out of the open worldwide, so we're going to be watching her all weekend long.
She already logged a third-place finish in event number one, so as long as she's solid here, she's sitting in really good shape to get into day number two. And it's Branham on the right in the all black, and on the left, the familiar face, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. And Camille is back. This is where she should really excel and make up, no, not make up the time, but really space herself out for the rest, as Trevorani on the rings. A lot of people back to the rings quickly.
And what you want to do when you are scanning those big shots is you want to see who's moving quickly, who's doing larger sets, who's not pausing. Right there, we just saw an amazing set right there by, I want to say that was Annette.
Anita Pravati out of Sao Paulo, Brazil. Pam CrossFit, or PAM CrossFit, a regional veteran. Back to Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, trying to beat Jessica Alouette, who just crushed the event record. She is at 3:48.93.
And at this pace, she can still beat that event record that was done just a while ago.
Rachel Campbell, the white shorts, black top, joining Camille and Anita. But right now, it's Anita Pravati right there in the middle of your screen, multicolored top, black shorts. Again, currently in second, trying to chase down Camille, and they are in their final sets of five.
Anita had fast ring dips. She did a nice big set of ring dips. Now we'll see if she has stamina in the ring dips on this second set of 15. This one is much more difficult than that first set of 21.
I think Pravati moved a little bit quicker on the snatches. We'll see how they move in the rings, because Camille got to the rings at the exact same time running down there.
And when you watch them, they're moving rep for rep right now, and they bounced off at about the same time. So it's going to be about transitions. How long are they resting?
Pravati breaks on the right. Camille stops on the left.
She had a little larger set, Camille did.
Nice and smooth, and Camille, of course, leads off the dips, and she gets into her set of nine. They'll move up the dumbbell every 3 reps on the set of 9. Right now, has a pretty good lead, because Pravati is still back doing ring dips, so Camille has now separated from the pack.
And for those athletes who have not gone yet in a regional, and the regionals are coming, the women who've done really well on this, they're not taking their hands off of the rings. They're staying there. They're making those transitions super short when they're over there at those rings.
That's Brenda Castro, came in with a lot of hype, number one out of the Latin American, got an 8th place finish in event one, which is very good, but she's really laboring here in event two. Here is Camille. She's got to have a shot here. Again, 3:48.93 is the event record just set. For body has fallen off pace on the right. 9 ring dips and a sprint to the other end of the Alamo Dome.
If she does all 9, she can do it.
She does it. She's got 20 seconds to get down there. No problem for Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. Event record for the 2014 champ.
And what do we have but a first place in event 1, a first place in event 2. She said she wasn't here to make a statement, but she's doing it anyways. I'll say she made a statement today on Friday.
Regional defending champion, 2014 champion, longtime games veteran, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. What a day here, as Rachel Campbell is in out of Redside CrossFit in Leander, Texas.
That's going to be a great finish for Rachel to bring her up the leaderboard.
A little less than 2 minutes remaining here in the time cap. Here we go. Well, it looks like that's going to be Alexis Johnson. Margo Alvarez gets in. And she needed a good finish. Struggled a little bit today in event number one, but a nice comeback in event two for Margo.
That's going to get her somewhere in the, 5 to 10 range placing out of these women, and she needed that.
That's Anita Pravati, who was going head-to-head for a while with Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, and on that set of 15 ring dips, She fell off the pace. Of course, that's a big strength for Camille. And now across in lane number 7, Alexis Johnson out of All Sport CrossFit in Houston, Texas.
You've got about 5 of the women still on the field. This is exactly what we saw in the last heat as well, about half of the women still on the field at this 5-minute mark.
Brenda Castro, there she is running back to the rig. She needs to really throttle up here with under a minute to go. Needs really to get in under the time cap after getting an 8th place finish earlier today to stay in one of the later heats tomorrow. Lane number 10 at the bottom of your screen is Luisa Diaz out of ELO CrossFit. Looks like Bethany Branham out of Hutto, Texas, and CrossFit Hutto, one of the athletes to watch for the weekend. She will get in, but Brenda Castro there. And Castro in a foot race and cannot afford to let Annalisa Marquez get ahead of her and take a few points, but that is what Marquez does.
She just had a sprint or a little fire in her feet right there.
Time.
Going to break, what she was going to do when she was going to break, and she knew she had it for all 45, so she did not run out of steam, and we now have a new event record. Congratulations, Camille, for a first and a first on Friday.
So Camille does it. Good job on that last rep, not to panic. Just steadied herself, went back up for number 9, and she's standing by with Nick Zielinski.
Camille, another event victory for you today. Do you have any idea what the event records or time to beat is going into an event?
No, I don't. I don't look at anything because it doesn't matter. I'm just here to do my thing, so I have no idea.
Well, you're doing your thing. A first in event 1, a first in event 2. What are you going to do tonight to get this momentum and continue it tomorrow?
I don't know. I mean, for me, I'm just doing my best here, so whatever the outcome is, that's what it is. Of course, I'm happy then. It put me in a good spot, but I don't know. I'm going to eat, most likely watch a Disney movie or something like that, something very cheesy.
What Disney movie?
Well, last year I was into Kung Fu Panda, so I haven't chosen yet. Any recommendation?
My all-time favorite is probably Aladdin.
Are you kidding?
That's old school,
That's
though.
My favorite.
All right.
Here you go.
We did it.
Hercules, so maybe that one.
Okay. Camille, congratulations on a great day 1. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Camille will continue to spread the happy, as she said earlier today to Nick Zielinski, and she should. A couple of first place finishes, and here are the final results for event number 2.
Ooh, smoking times that you have for these ladies. I was hoping to see a sub 4, and we saw 4 sub 4s from the ladies here in the South Regional.
Jessica Alouette had a nice event too at 3:48. So it is going to be a fun race over the next 2 days. For all the official information and standings and event results, not only here in the South in the Alamo Dome, but up east in Albany, go to games.crossfit.com. In the meantime, we are going to go out to HQ for the update show momentarily. And they'll give you all the stories from the East and the South. That'll wrap it up for the Alamo Dome for day number 1. Should be an exciting day number 2. For Cherie Chan, I am Jeff Brightwell from the CrossFit South Regional.
Day 1 officially in the books for the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals. Welcome back inside the CrossFit Update Studios. I'm Sean Woodland with Annie Sakamoto and Pat Sherwood, Sam Farber, Tommy Marquez, and Caleb Banfield all here as well, as we are now going to recap what was, I think some things went as planned for the most part, but there were some surprises. But all in all, we saw two very different tests in the process.
Both for the teams and for the individuals. The teams, like we were saying earlier, there was some kind of individual-esque work that they had to get done, and then some very team-oriented work that they had to get done.
And we'll see if this trend continues. I feel rather confident that it will, but it's safe to say this regionals was extraordinarily different. We're only one day in, but the no barbell, right? And so what are we already seeing? Why are we talking about Camille Fraser, Valner, Travis Williams, Davis' daughter? Like, there is this thing called fitness, which exists, and you know, these things lend itself well to whatever the tasks are. It's not coincidence these people at the top. I think we're going to see, like we said, when these events were first announced, your 1, 2, and your 3 will be household names, and I'm curious to see if spots 4 and 5 over the next couple days bring some new people out to Madison, Wisconsin.
Let's start out at the East Regional, Albany, New York. They kick things off first. Men's competition, Matt Fraser finishes second and then first, 195 points for him. Patrick Vellner sits in second place, just 15 points back, 23 points separating 4th from 8th. There are 3 newcomers there in spots 3 through 5 as we head into day 1 of the weekend with 4 more events for the individuals, 2 tomorrow and then 2 again on Sunday. But let's start with Matt Fraser. And I know it's day 1. I know we still have plenty of time to go here in regionals, but it does look like if Matt Fraser wants to show up in Madison and win the CrossFit Games, Matt Fraser is going to show up in Madison and win the CrossFit Games.
Now, Matt Fraser has not yet done what Rich Froning has accomplished, okay? And that's, let's just say that, let's get that out there. But he has 100% earned the right to be in that kind of a conversation. The man's resume already is so incredible. He wins event number 1 out in his regional, 1458. Again, a no barbell in sight, and Matt Fraser has won. And his resume, so, you know, fittest man in the earth from 2016, he's sitting very well to make that a second gold medal around his neck. He's been to the Games 3 times. He's been on the podium every single solitary time he's gone to the Games. In his debut, he was the Rookie of the Year. He wasn't even focusing on the Open this year, and he won it. I mean, he just dominates his regionals. The guy seems to be unstoppable, and I don't know who can push him around.
Patrick Vellner is going to try. He currently sits in second place, but I just mentioned 3 new names there in spots 3 through 5. Tim Paulson, Max Bragg, and Austin Spencer. Of those 3, still have 4 events to go, but who do you think has the best chance of staying there?
At this point, I'm going to go with Tim Paulson. So even though he's not a household name, this is his 5th regional appearance. He co-owns CrossFit Palace in Ithaca, New York, and he's very dedicated to his training and trying to qualify for the Games. He finished the Worldwide Open in 24th this year. He had a solid first day with both a 6th place and a 1st place finish, so 2 finishes inside the top 10. I think he's looking good to qualify.
It's a pretty safe assumption to say that Matt Fraser and Patrick Vellner will be returning to the CrossFit Games, but who will be the 3 men who join them? For a closer look at that, here are Sam Farber and Tommy Marquez.
Yeah, Sean, I'd say that's pretty safe, but the other 3 guys, that's a different story. Now, Tommy's been working with the CrossFit analytics team, breaking down the numbers here. Tommy, what have you found in terms of the odds for those 3 that are currently in spots 3 through 5 staying in those positions?
Well, yeah, like you said, with 3 potential rookies inside the top 5, we took a look at, well, how likely are they to stay in the top 5, and more importantly, what they have to do to accomplish staying inside the top 5 and getting to the Games. Last year, 67.5% of athletes who finished day 1 inside the top 5 stayed inside the top 5 and qualified for the Games. Looking at the 5th and final spot as the cut line, the 5th place finisher at regionals last year had an average event finish of 7th. If you take that placement and apply it to the 6 events this year, you get a magic number of 438 points. That's what they need to get to the Games based on last year's number and finish in the top 5. With that in mind, here's what those 3 athletes, Paulson, Bragg, and Spencer, need to average across the remaining 4 events to hit that magic number and give themselves a shot based on last year's numbers at going to the Games. Obviously, Paulson has a little bit more breathing room with that 11th based on his performances in day number 1.
So those are the numbers. Now let's look at this a little bit more. In reality, we have seen some attrition, especially in this region, with some of the top competitors dropping out. How likely is it that those 3 guys are able to hit the numbers?
Well, if you use that 67.5% number and you kind of assume that Matt Fraser and Patrick Vellner are going to stay inside that top 5, well, really that means only one of those 3 guys is going to stay. Obviously, Tim has more breathing room based on his performance. He's got about 20, 25 points on those other guys and a few placements needed on average. So it's looking good for Tim.
Great job on the analytics, the Moneyball version of the CrossFit Games through day one. Let's send it back to Sean and the guys on the desk.
Thank you, Sam and Tommy. Let's move on to the women's side of things in the East Regional and some very familiar names on top of the leaderboard. But one you probably didn't expect to be leading after two events. Carol Ann Reason Tebow, perfect through two events, winning them both. She sits in first place. Katherine David's daughter with 185 points is in second. And then a couple games veterans, Carrie Pierce and Danny Horan. And it's Chelsea Hughes who currently hangs on to the fifth and final spot there. Just 20 points, so it's close. Separate third from seventh place. To Katherine David's daughter, doing what she does, has not won an event, but has yet to finish lower than third.
Katherine, second place after day one here at the 2017 East Regional. You're the two-time defending champion. How do you stay motivated to keep coming back year after year?
There are so many things to keep getting better at. I love the everyday. I love working out. I love coming to the gym. If it were any day in the world, holiday, vacation, I'd want to do what I'm doing. So coming back from the games and still feeling like every day me and men have so much that we can work on and so much to get better at, I think that's what keeps me coming like to the gym every day.
So as the two-time defending champion, what is there left for you to work on?
Everything. What I'm good at, I can get better at. My weaknesses, I can get better at. Literally everything. Yeah.
Katherine Davis' daughter looking to win three straight CrossFit Games. He's well on her way to at least getting back to the games, but Carol Ann Reason Tebow, someone I think we expected to be in one of those five spots, but I don't think any of us saw her leading after day one.
I definitely did not. No. I was looking at Carrie Pierce. I was looking at Katrin. I thought that Carol Ann would qualify, but not in this fashion, at least not with this first day. And she has just been quietly and steadily getting better and better. 2015, she qualified fourth in the region. She got 27th at the games. Then last year, she qualified second in the regionals and got 14th place at the CrossFit Games. She was invited to the CrossFit Invitational. This year, she finishes sixth in the Worldwide Open. She's the top seed out of the Canada East region. And then to finish today with two first places and the most composed look through both of those workouts. All eyes
super
on Carol Ann now.
Yeah. In fourth and fifth, you have Danny Horan with 159 points, and then 4 points back of her is Chelsea Hughes. Going to be a good fight for those, you know, three through five. But of the two, Horan and Hughes, who do you think has the best chance to stay?
This is a great battle because Hughes has been battling to try to get to the games as an individual and has missed it a couple times. Danny Horan is looking to get back, but I think it goes to Danny Horan. I'm going to give it to the veteran in these pressure situations. She's trying to make it back to the games for the fourth time. She's had a last couple of years, but she's kept her head in the game. She's kept grinding. Last year at regionals, she missed qualifying by just one little point. It came down to her and Tasia Persevich, and it went to Tasia the year before, 2015. She qualified, but had to pull out due to a neck injury. I actually spoke with Danny on the phone, and she said this year she was nervous because she cut her training volume in half. And, of course, if you're doing less, you feel like you're going to be less, but that wasn't the case. The lower volume, she ramped up the intensity, and I think that is probably serving her very well in these regionals.
Yeah, let's send you back out to Albany, New York. Brandon Domain, Tanya Wagner, and Rob Orlando were there all day calling the action, and they have a closer look at day one of the East Regional.
Thanks, Sean. Back here in Albany at the Times Union Center after a pretty hectic opening day of competition. We all had the thought on the women's side somebody was going to go two for two. Most people thought Carrie Pierce. Instead, Carol Ann Reason Tebow with 200 points after day one.
Reason Tebow just showed she has come so far. Fifth time to the region. She took 14th at last year's games, and she had a perfect day. 200 points were on the line. She took all of them. Event one was spot on with her fast transitions. The weight vest looked like it wasn't even on her. Event two was just as clean. She was super fast in the dumbbell snatches, really efficient on the ring dips, and her quick transitions got her the win again. So impressive, especially being that she was side-by-side with Carrie Pierce, who I expected to set the records, but it was Reason Tebow, and I'm so excited to see what she's going to bring tomorrow.
Now, two for two on day number one to hold the points lead going into the second day. Points leader on the men's side is Matt Fraser, Patrick Vellner with him, but the action and the story was really on what happened in the second event with a lot of athletes that had a real bad time.
We had four men's athletes on the ring dips drop off with pec injuries.
injuries. Two of them are out of the competition for good, and we've got two of them that are questionable for tomorrow. So 10% of the competition could potentially be out here.
And Christian Harris and Corey Lunny are the two that are out. That is for not meeting the minimum work requirement. Here was Chase Smith, the last of them. He was the leader in that final heat at the time of his injury on those ring dips, and that's when everything really changed in that event. But we'll get an update as soon as we can on them. We'll be back here tomorrow morning at 9 for the team action. Until then, let's go back to Sean in the studio.
All right, thank you very much, Brandon. Want to thank everybody who worked really hard there at East Day 1. And as they said, tomorrow, 9 a.m. Eastern Time, they will kick off day number 2 with the team competition. Want to welcome in Tommy Marquez as we turn our attention now to the South men's competition. We do not have the we do have the overall leaderboard now after two events. And it's Logan Collins has a 10-point lead over Travis Williams. Dakota Rager, who had the lead after one event, currently sits in third. Tommy Venus and Cooper Wise rounding out the top five, but a lot of familiar names down there. Elijah Muhammad just 2 points out. Joseph Gesser on the bubble. He's 11 points out, but they have time to work their way back in to the top five. But it's Logan Collins. Doesn't win an event, but he had 2 third-place finishes to put himself on top of the leaderboard after day one.
Logan, 2 very good finishes for you in day one. How would you classify day one? How did it stack up to your expectations?
Had a couple slip-ups on event one. I think I held top three on that, so I was hoping for a first-place finish for sure on that one, as well as this one, but those boys were going pretty quick on that, the heats before us, so it just says that you can't really rely on, you know, your heat and how fast that's going to be. So tomorrow, just come out, focus on what I can do, and stay within myself, but try to sneak out some more good placements. So, yeah.
He just said tomorrow's a lot of pain. I think we can tell Logan Collins likes pain. He'll be great tomorrow. Logan, thank you very much. Congrats.
Thanks,
if we have learned anything, we know that in the South Regional, it is not over until it is over. Logan Collins, though, has the lead heading into day number 2. 2 third-place finishes in 2 very different events. So you got to think he has a good shot of staying in the top 5 when it's all said and done.
He does. You're right. But it is the South, mm-hmm. like you said. I'm not sure who's sitting in 31st, but they may win the whole thing, of course, in the next couple of days. But Logan Collins, so impressive. He went to the games last year as a rookie, where he placed 31st. Last year at this regional, he took 3rd. But, man, he is hammering it this year. He's just 5'7", 172 pounds. He's got a 2-minute and 2-second Fran. He is blazing fast. He has an engine. You're like, okay, 172, 202 Fran. He's not a big guy. He's not very strong. He's got a 455 back squat and a 525-pound deadlift. We've got a lot of heavy wall balls coming up tomorrow, some rope climbs. We've got the kettlebell deadlifts. Day 2 actually shakes out pretty well for him.
In 3rd and 4th, you have Dakota Rager, who led after the first event. Tommy Venus is just 11 points back of him, but there are plenty of talented men lurking behind them. But of those two, who do you think has the best shot of staying in the top 5?
Well, I'm tempted to say both, but if I have to pick one, I'm going to go with Tommy Venus. Just looking at the spread between his 2 workouts, Dakota Rager obviously has the better finish with that first place. But Tommy, a 4th and a 7th, a little bit more consistency between the 2 workouts than Rager had, having the 1st and the 9th. And you want to see the smaller spread over the course of 6 full events. With that 17-point cushion, I think Tommy is a little bit larger athlete. He's going to handle the deadlift, the wall balls, and have a little bit more height advantage on those rope climbs.
Let's go over to the women's side of things. And there's something about French-Canadian women today, because Carol Ann Reeds and Thibault went 2 for 2. Camila Blanc-Bazinet, 2 for 2. 200 points at the end of day number 1. The only Canadian on the board here. Of course, she relocated to the South Regional, but she is 15 points up on Tenille Reed. Jessica Elvoe with 160. Alexis Johnson and then Candace Wagner rounding out the top 5, but then plenty of athletes still within striking distance as we head into day number 2. But for Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, it is business as usual at the Regional.
Camille, another event victory for you today. Do you have any idea what the event records or time to beat is going into an event?
No, I don't look at anything, because it doesn't matter. I'm just here to do my thing, so I have no idea.
Well, you're doing your thing. A 1st in event 1, a 1st in event 2. What are you gonna do tonight to get this momentum and continue it tomorrow?
I don't know. I mean, for me, I'm just doing my best here, so whatever the outcome is, that's what it is. Of course, I'm happy that they put me in a good spot, but I don't know. I'm going to eat. Most likely watch a Disney movie or something like that. Something very cheesy.
What Disney movie?
Well, last year I was into Kung Fu Panda. So I haven't chosen yet. Any recommendation?
My all-time favorite is probably Aladdin.
Are you kidding?
That's old school,
That's
though.
My favorite.
All right.
Here you go.
We did it.
And then Hercules, so maybe that one.
Okay. Well, Camille, congratulations on a great day one. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Good to see Nick Zielinski and Camila Blanc-Vaznay bonding over Disney movies. I mean, you just always get the unexpected stuff there at regionals. But for Camila Blanc-Vaznay, we talked about this earlier, she's always been dominant at the regional level. But for the past couple of years, that has not translated into the results she's wanted at the CrossFit Games. Here she is again. She's gone 2 for 2. Are we seeing a different Camila Blanc-Vaznay, or can we even tell yet?
I hope that we are. I think that we might be. I mean, this is her 8th regionals. She's got so much experience, it's ridiculous. And like you said, she is a savage at regionals. And she knows that while she's incredibly fit, if she does have a weakness or an area that needed improvement, it was between the years. And she has focused on that and tried to improve that as well. And I think she's one of those athletes, she's like a momentum athlete. When things are going well, man, get out of her way, because she just feeds off that energy. I think she's learned how to deal with not doing well better, but what does she have right now? 2 first place finishes. I mean, that's the Camille that just steamrolls the competition.
Margo Alvarez is another Games athlete. She started after event number one in 16th place, and we were saying, well, should she be worried? She has moved up the leaderboard. Now she sits in 7th place. She's only 10 points back of Candace Wagner for 5th place. Is she feeling any better right now?
Oh, without a doubt. I think also because she's only 10 points, which is pretty negligible over the course of the next 4 events, but also because she got a movement in handstand pushups that has typically kind of been a tough movement for her, really. And you take a look at what she did last year. After day one, she was 7th in the West. So she's certainly not unfamiliar. She's certainly not unfamiliar for being in this position in particular. And I think if you look at what's ahead, you've got event 3 in particular with the lunges, wall balls, rope climbs, some movements that she does very well in. I think she's going to come out swinging and going to make up those 10 points immediately.
And she definitely has, you know, the mental side of the game locked down, so I'm sure she will not be fazed by what's going on tomorrow or the fact that she's sitting outside of the top 5. There's been a ton of stuff going on social media. Kayla Banfield has been sifting through all of that and helping us keep track of what you, the CrossFit community, have been talking about all day long. Kayla, what has been the buzz on social media today?
Sean, we have had so much stuff coming through our social media channels today, and I've absolutely loved keeping an eye on all of it. We've had stuff coming through from athletes, we've had stuff coming through from our supporters. My personal favorite is those that are checking in while at work or multitasking, watching regionals while doing something else. A couple of our featured photos today. Sorry if the box isn't spotless this week. Regionals has started. And look, I'm sure the community will understand that you've had pretty important things at the front of your mind today, and I'm sure the box can be cleaned next week. Gerard Andrews says he's making sure he didn't miss any of the CrossFit Games regionals tonight during training. And we have Northlake89 watching CrossFit Games while working on abs. And I can imagine that watching the CrossFit Games is pretty motivating when it comes to doing ab workouts. Now, it's no secret we've got plenty to watch this weekend. We've got the South Regional, we've got the East Regional, we have Facebook Live, we've got our YouTube channels. So with all of that viewing in mind, tomorrow we want to ask you, how are you getting your fitness in? You can basically wake up in the morning and watch CrossFit throughout the whole day until you go to bed at night. So we want to know, whether you're at the stadium or whether you're at home, how are you getting your fitness in tomorrow? If you've got something for us, please tag South Regional or Ask CFG. Guys at the desk, we have long days here. Are you guys going to be fitting in any workouts this weekend?
No, I will be not working on my fit. I'll be working on my fatness. We got this jug of peanut butter filled pretzels up there.
Oh, yeah.
That thing is in danger of being inhaled by me when we're all done.
That's the warm up right there.
Yeah.
I usually try to take Thursdays and Sundays off, but during this time of year, I try to work out Monday through Friday. So if I sneak in a workout today, I don't have to worry about tomorrow or the next day. And so luckily I got one this morning. But 2 more weeks.
You're a better man than I am.
I work out every day at regionals because I'm part of this thing called the Cup of Judgment, which is a fun little competition between some of us on the media team, some of the head judges, some other event people. that are involved with the workouts. And right now, I'm on a team with Rory McKernan, who's at Albany Regional, and one of our producers up in the control room, Charlie Doobie. And we're on Team Magic of Television, a.k.a. Team Smoke and Mirrors. I think we took down event number one yesterday, so we're going to lay it down on event number two and, you know, knock out Boz and the rest of those
guys. Represent the desk.
Oh, yeah.
You better bring it home for the media team. Now that we know, we're going to be checking in with you and seeing how those standings are going. The South is done for the day. They just wrap things up. Let's send it back to San Antonio, Texas. Jeff Brightwell, James Hobart, and Sheree Chan wrapping up day one of the South Regional.
Day one has come to a close in downtown San Antonio at the Alamo Dome. I'm Jeff Wright alongside Sheree Chan and James Hobart as we wrap up day one action, where our leaders are Logan Collins, Camille LeBlanc-Bazadeh, and the Wasatch Brutes in team competition. It's been fun. We've seen some long time domains and some shorter sprints of a whole lot of different implements. Sheree, first of all, your thoughts on day one.
My full thoughts on day was I'm not surprised, I have to say. You know, Wasatch Brutes came in with a lot of experience, so I wasn't surprised there. And I can't say I was surprised to see Camille LeBlanc on top.
James?
Experience wins. I agree with Sheree on that point. You're going to see a lot of athletes who have been here and been to the games at the top again. I haven't seen the dumbbell be a huge problem for these guys. I don't think you'll see that until day three with those overhead squats.
You mentioned dumbbells, no barbells. A lot was kind of made of it in the community. Wow, no barbells. Sheree, good, bad, how'd you feel?
Entirely depends on how you train. I don't think it will make a difference for your top athletes, but it definitely will make a difference for your athletes who are either newer, they're rookies, they only ever touch a barbell. It will be significant for them.
I saw people more challenged today on the gymnastics stuff, actually. The dumbbell range of motion standards were easy. It was grip and rip. Like I said, maybe day three with the overhead squats, that's when you see the dumbbell start to play a big difference and add a challenge.
Well, that wraps it up for day one of competition. Come back tomorrow, day two, as we started out with the teams from the Alamo Dome. That'll wrap things up from San Antonio, Texas. For Sheree Chan, James Hobart, I'm Jeff Brightwell. Now back to the HQ studios.
Thanks a lot, Jeff. Look forward to hearing from that crew tomorrow as we kick off day number two. That's going to do it for day number one. But, hey, we got you covered all weekend long. You're hopefully not going to have to watch from work, so get comfortable at the house. Get your multiple screens out. We will have all kinds of coverage for you throughout the day. We will be here in the studio as well. And remember, keep all the comments coming on social media. For Pat Sherwood, Tommy Marquez, Sam Farber, and Caleb Banfield and Brooke Entz, I'm Sean Woodland. See ya on day two of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals.